Those who, unfortunately, we've seen in just the recent weeks, soldiers and service members who have paid the ultimate price in Afghanistan specifically. And starting with the Pledge of Allegiance, remembering what it is that unites us all. We don't have a whole lot of time today, so I'm going to keep my remarks relatively brief, and then I really want to hear what's on your mind and answer any questions that you have. But I think it's important that that we start on the tone and the message that Joe opened our conversation up with. What is it that brings us together as a country? What does it mean to be an American? Why do we pledge allegiance to this flag? What does it stand for? In a time where we as a country are facing such incredible divides, we're seeing how people in positions of power, whether they be politicians or people of big influence, they try to tear us apart. They try to put us in one box or another and pit one group against the other. We're seeing a lot of this in Washington happening with the hyper-partisanship. We have two political parties who are very powerful and are more interested in defeating the other than actually saying, hey, who are we as Americans? How do we come together and work together for the well-being of our country and the people in our country who are facing incredible challenges, who are struggling, living paycheck to paycheck, just trying to make ends meet, make sure they've got a roof over their heads for their family, concerned about a healthcare emergency that may come, but they don't have the money to pay for it, thinking about the future for our kids. What kind of future will we leave for them? How will we help equip them to be successful in this quickly changing global community and economy? There are so many very real issues and challenges that we face, but so long as we remain divided as a country, so long as we see this tribalism continuing, we will never get to that place where we're actually solving the root cause of so many of these problems. Coming together, unifying our country, recognizing that we shouldn't be afraid to sit down and have a conversation with someone who disagrees with us, and that this unity can only happen when we come together in the spirit of what we in Hawaii call aloha, which really means respect. There's a reason why people think aloha means hello or goodbye. Some say it means I love you. There's a lot of confusion about what it actually means, but we use this as a greeting because of what it really means. And what it means is I come to you with an open heart. I come to you with respect, that I recognize that we are all connected. We are all brothers and sisters. We are all children of God. And then this inspires us to see past all of the things that are used to divide us, all these superficial labels, and allows us to be able to build that foundation of respect, to heal those divisive wounds, and see each other for who we are so that we may come together and move forward together. You know, at every one of our events we have, you may have noticed if you signed in here, we have copies of our Constitution and Bill of Rights. There are things that are too often forgotten. In our day-to-day discourse, certainly in Washington, we see abuses of our constitutional rights and abuse of, talking about Afghanistan. We've seen over time this erosion of the constitutional responsibilities that both Congress has as being the body that the Constitution says must declare war, and an abuse of power from the executive branch across administrations, bypassing Congress, not getting that congressional declaration and going and waging wars. So what are these wars? What is this cost of war that Joe is alluding to? He's talking about a very real human cost, a human cost that is paid for by every single one of us who has worn the uniform or continues to wear the uniform, those who pay the ultimate price, those who were able to make that long trip home but come home with both visible and invisible wounds. Those experiences, those memories, they never really go away. But there's a cost to this constant regime change war status that we've been in for so long that is paid for by every single one of us. Every single one of us. Something that hardly ever gets talked about, but it should be, because it's at the center of our ability to be able to say, okay, we've got a limited amount of taxpayer dollars and resources. Where are those going? How can they best be used to serve the needs of our people? This is the kinds of conversations we should be having. We'll put it towards healthcare, we'll put it towards education, towards infrastructure, towards the basic needs that we have. But instead, what we've seen since 9/11, 2001, over $6 trillion of our taxpayer dollars has gone to pay for these wasteful, counterproductive regime change wars that have not only proven to be so costly to our men and women in uniform, but they've actually undermined our national security. They've strengthened terrorist groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda. They've caused a great devastation and destruction in the countries where we wage these wars. And we see that we, in the years that pass, it's not only the wars themselves, but it's the ongoing nation building in these other countries that follows that. Meanwhile, we have folks here in our country who can't drink the water that's coming out of their taps because it's poisonous and toxic. You know, we have communities who are struggling because of failing infrastructure, whether it's waters or sewers, you know, septic tanks. We have farmers who are struggling because of failing levees. You've seen this in some of the communities we visited here in Iowa. In Pacific Junction, we went and we were helping some of the families who were trying to recover from the floods and the failed levees that they saw there. And they were being told it may be years before those levees are rebuilt, leaving them wondering, where do they go? What do they do? There are very real challenges and needs that we need to address here at home. And so our foreign policy, the cost of war, the most important responsibility that the president has to serve as commander-in-chief is central to every single other one of these issues that we face. It is central. You can't separate it. So unlike what some people may believe, they say, oh, you know, foreign policy is just one issue. Why do you talk about foreign policy so much, Tulsi? It's because, yes, I've personally seen the cost of war, the terrible high human cost. But as a member of Congress, now I've served for nearly 7 years on the Foreign Affairs Committee, the Armed Services Committee, the Homeland Security Committee. I understand very deeply the importance of our national security and the cost and consequences of these decisions that are made. So I'm running for president to bring about a sea change in our foreign policy, to bring these values and principles of service above self to the White House, to our presidency, restoring the principles of honor and integrity and respect to the presidency, and to walk in on day one, prepared to lead as commander-in-chief, ending these wasteful regime change wars, working to end this new Cold War and arms race that we're in with escalating tensions between the United States and nuclear-armed countries like Russia and China, more money going to build more of these nuclear bombs and missiles, and instead redirect our resources back towards serving the needs of our people here at home. This is the change that I'm seeking to bring about. This is why I'm here asking for your support to join me. Thank you so much.